Hi, welcome to my channel. In today's video, I want to talk about two very commonly discussed nuclear reactions. These are very important nuclear reactions because one of them is responsible for nuclear explosions, while the other is responsible for the very life on our planet because this is what provides energy to the sun. So they are known as nuclear fission and nuclear fusion. In nuclear fission, a large nucleus breaks down into smaller nuclei, while in nuclear fusion, smaller nuclei combine together to form a large nucleus. Before I talk about what they are, let's first spend a little bit of a time discussing why they happen. Why is it that such huge amounts of energy can be released or are released in these kind of nuclear reactions? To understand why this happens, first I have to talk about what is nuclear binding energy. Nuclear binding energy basically gives us an idea about how bound a nucleus really is. So let's suppose that there are free neutrons and free protons which come together to create a nucleus. This kind of a process is usually followed by the release of energy. Why is it that energy is released? Before I talk about that, let's first draw a diagram. So let's suppose that these free protons and free neutrons somehow come together and create this kind of a nucleus. This nucleus is bound because of attractive forces where the neutrons and protons are held together. Whenever this kind of a process happens, it is usually followed by the release of huge amounts of energy, maybe let's suppose in the form of a gamma photon. Now you might ask a question here then, why is it that energy is released during this kind of a process? To answer the question, we can answer it in one way. So one way is to, let's imagine that there is a nucleus which is stable. If you want to break that nucleus and free up all the neutrons and protons, you have to provide external energy. Only if you provide an external energy, you can break up the nucleus into its constituent particles. So the reverse process is basically this. So in this reverse process, you provide some sort of an energy to a nucleus so as to break it apart and free up all the neutrons and protons. The very same thing is happening, but in reverse here. The reverse process is basically when neutrons and protons come together, then they end up creating a nucleus which is compact in a particular volume, and this process leads to the emission of some sort of an energy. This kind of an energy is known as binding energy. This is called binding energy because this gives us an idea about what is the amount of energy released during this binding process. So you can define binding energy as the amount of energy which is released when free neutrons and protons come together to create a compact nucleus. Or you can also define binding energy as that amount of energy which is necessary to break a compact nucleus into its constituent particles. This binding energy gives us an idea how much amount of energy is involved when you either want to break apart a nucleus or you want to create that nucleus from its constituent particles. There is another way of defining binding energy, and that way is quite simply if you look at the mass of the free particles and the nucleus. Usually you'd expect that if these particles are creating a nucleus, then the mass of both these two sides should be equal, right? But not in the case of nuclear reactions. If you look at the mass of all these free protons and free neutrons, then you will find that this mass is not the same as the mass of the nucleus itself. Quite surprising, right? The mass of the particles which make up the nucleus is not equal to the mass of the nucleus itself. In fact, if you look at the mass of the particles and the mass of the nucleus, you would find that the mass of the particles is greater than the mass of the nucleus. And this difference is known as mass defect. It is basically this mass defect which leads to the creation of or release of energy in this kind of a reaction in the first place. So if you want to calculate the binding energy, then calculate it from the mass defect. So the binding energy which is released in this kind of a process is simply the mass defect times the C square. So this gives us the amount of energy which is released. So in a way you can say that whenever this process takes place, the mass defect is the one which leads to the emission of this kind of an energy. Now, why am I talking about all of these things? I am talking about these things because binding energy gives us an idea about the stability of a nucleus. How? Well, the harder it is to break apart a nucleus, that means the more energy it is required to break a nucleus, the more stable it is, right? Because the easier it is to break apart a nucleus, or the lesser energy that it is required to break apart a nucleus, the less stable it is. Yes. So greater binding energy means more energy is required to break a nucleus, so it is more stable. And lesser binding energy means less energy is required to break apart a nucleus, so it is less stable. So in a way, binding energy gives us an idea about stability. Greater binding energy, greater stability. Lower binding energy, lower stability. So greater binding energy of a nucleus gives us an idea that it is more stable. Now the thing is, binding energy also depends upon mass number. That means how many particles are inside a nucleus. If you have a nucleus that contains 10 protons and 10 neutrons, and you compare its binding energy with another nucleus that contains 20 protons and 20 neutrons, then you will find that the bigger nucleus has greater binding energy. Now, if I want to compare the stability of different nuclei having different sizes, how can we do that? To understand the problem, let's look at these few examples. So, the binding energy of deuterium, which is basically a hydrogen isotope having one proton and one neutron, the binding energy is basically equal to 2.2 mega electron volt. Fine. Now, if you look at the binding energy of oxygen, which has a mass number of 16 and 8 protons, its binding energy comes out to be around 127.6 mega electron volt, which is quite huge, of course, because there are 16 particles here. And if you look at another bigger nucleus, let's suppose bismuth, which has 209 mass number, out of which 83 are protons, then its binding energy comes out to be around 1640 mega electron volt. So bigger the nucleus, bigger is the total amount of binding energy. So I just told you that greater binding energy compares to higher stability. However, when you go from smaller to larger nuclei, how do you compare the stability of a small nucleus as opposed to a bigger nucleus? Of course, as you go to a bigger nucleus, the binding energy also increases. So you need to come up with some kind of a quantity which would give us a comparison between the stability of a smaller nucleus and a larger nucleus. And to do that, we have what is known as binding energy per nucleon, or binding energy divided by the mass number. If you divide, because binding energy is basically proportional to the number of particles which are inside the nucleus, to compare different sized nucleus, we can find out the binding energy per nucleon of different kinds of elements. So for example, for deuterium, the binding energy per nucleon comes out to be around 1.1 mega electron volt, while for oxygen, the binding energy per nucleon comes out to be around 7.9 mega electron volts, and for bismuth, the binding energy per nucleon comes out to be around 7.8 mega electron volts. So as you can see, even for different sized nucleus, the binding energy per nucleon comes out to have comparable values, and we can compare these to get a relative idea about the stability of different kinds of nucleus. So if you find out the binding energy per nucleon for all the elements in our periodic table, then you get what is known as the binding energy curve, which you probably might know, or you might have seen this before. This is the binding energy curve, where in the x-axis you have the mass number, or the number of neutrons and protons inside a nucleus, and on the y-axis you have the binding energy per nucleon, or binding energy divided by the mass number. This graph is quite interesting, and you can get a lot of idea about stability and about nuclear fission and fusion from this graph. Because if you see, as the mass number increases, the binding energy per nucleon suddenly increases. It reaches some sort of a peak here near mass number 56. And beyond this, it again starts decreasing. Now, what does this tell us about the nature of nuclear reactions? So what I'm trying to say is, if there is some kind of a nuclear reaction where some sort of a nucleus A transforms into another nucleus B, let's suppose. Alright, so there was a nucleus A which had some sort of a binding energy, it transforms into another nucleus having another binding energy. In this case, we can tell whether energy is going to be released or absorbed based upon the binding energy of this A and B. If the binding energy of B is greater than the binding energy of A, that means that stability has increased, the nucleus has become more bound. So in this process, energy is going to be released. Whenever a nuclear transformation takes place which increases the binding energy, then energy is always released. So if a nuclear transformation takes place in which the final product has a greater binding energy per nucleon, then energy is always released in the process. If the reverse happens, if bound nuclear structure becomes less bound, then energy needs to be absorbed in that particular case. Now, what does this tell us in this particular graph? So let's suppose that you have a nuclear reaction here. So let's suppose you take some kind of a nucleus which is very, very small, and then you fuse it with another nucleus to get a little bit of a larger nucleus. All right, if you do this process, then what you actually see is that two smaller nuclei fuse together to create this kind of a larger, a little bit of a larger nucleus. Now if you see here, the this process is accompanied by an increase in the binding energy. Why? Because if you look here at the binding energy of this nucleus, and the binding energy of this nucleus is less compared to the binding energy per nucleon of the final product. So this process is accompanied by an increase in the binding energy per nucleon. Because of this reason, this process will lead to an emission of energy in the process. Whenever binding energy per nucleon increases in this kind of a nuclear reaction, stability increases, so therefore energy is released in the process. This kind of a nuclear reaction is known as nuclear fusion reaction. On the other side of the graph, if you see here, binding energy is decreasing as the mass number increases. So a same or a similar thing can be said, but in an opposite manner. That means if you have a large nucleus, all right, and somehow this large nucleus broke apart into two smaller nuclei, let's suppose, all right. So in this case, what is going to happen is that the binding energy of the large nucleus is lesser compared to the binding energy per nucleon of the smaller daughter nuclei. So if this large nuclei breaks apart into these two smaller nuclei, then the binding energy of this larger nuclei is smaller compared to the binding energy per nucleon of this daughter nuclei. So in a way, this nuclear reaction leads to increasing the binding energy per nucleon and the stability of these daughter nuclei. So this process is also accompanied by a release of energy. Whenever a nuclear transformation happens, where stability increases, the nuclear final product becomes more bound, or it has greater binding energy per nucleon, then always energy is going to be released. In both these two cases, because you are going up the binding energy curve, energy is released in the process. You are going up the binding energy curve, energy is released in the process. However, if you look at the reverse, so for example, if you take some kind of a large nucleus here, which breaks apart into two smaller nuclei, then this will not be accompanied by a release of energy, because you are going down the binding energy ladder. Okay, and similarly, if you take two smaller nuclei here, which combine to create a larger nucleus, this will not lead to a release in energy, because you are going down the binding energy curve. All right, so this process can only happen in these two areas of the graph. So we can divide this entire graph into these two areas. So this is one half, which is separated by a line of Mach number somewhere around 56, and this is another side of the graph where we look at the right side of the graph for mass number is greater than 56. So combination of smaller nuclei to create a larger nuclei will emit energy only when we are doing it in the left hand side of this particular graph, and breaking a larger nucleus to create us two smaller nuclei will lead to emission of energy only when we are doing it on the right hand side of this graph. All right, so in a way, this binding energy per nucleon curve gives us an idea about why nuclear fission and fusion are possible and when they are possible. They are only possible when they happen only in these parts of the graph. To summarize, huge amounts of energy is released because in these processes the binding energy per nucleon is increasing as the reaction happens, and therefore stability is increasing. All right, so when you go from some sort of a nuclear configuration with low stability to greater stability, then you end up releasing energy in this kind of a process. This is what is fundamentally responsible for huge amounts of energy emitted in nuclear fission and nuclear fusion. Now let's talk about what they are. Let me give an example of what nuclear fission is and what nuclear fusion is.
Here we have a common reaction of nuclear fission. So in this case, you have a thermal neutron. By thermal neutron, it means a slow-moving neutron. It hits a uranium-235 nucleus. So when this thermal neutron hits the uranium-235, it basically creates a very unstable state of uranium-236, which immediately breaks apart into barium-141 and krypton-92. And in that process, it leads to the release of three neutrons themselves. This is a common example of a nuclear fission reaction where a large nucleus breaks apart into two smaller nuclei. We can calculate the binding energy difference and therefore the total amount of energy which is released by simply looking at the mass defect involved. So if you look at the mass of the neutron plus the mass of the uranium-235, then this would be greater than the mass of all of these products. So if I minus the mass of 141 barium and minus the mass of 92 krypton and minus the mass of three times the mass of neutrons, then this will basically give us the total amount of mass defect involved in this nuclear reaction, and this mass defect leads to huge amounts of energy which is released along with this particular process. Okay, so this is a common nuclear reaction, and this is one of the nuclear reactions which can either facilitate a nuclear bomb explosion or it can facilitate the creation of energy in a nuclear reactor. So let me take a moment to distinguish between these two. So as you can see here, one neutron induces a nuclear transformation and leads to the emission of three neutrons, right? So if let's suppose that each individual neutron also goes and collides with another individual uranium nucleus. If such a case happens, then all of these individual reactions are basically the same as this one. So this will also lead to the release of three neutrons. This will also lead to the release of three neutrons. And this will also lead to the release of three neutrons, which can themselves again induce this kind of a nuclear reaction. So whenever this kind of a nuclear reaction happens, where one neutron induces one nuclear fission reaction, but it also leads to the emission of three neutrons, which individually can induce three separate nuclear reactions, which again release three neutrons, that means total of nine neutrons, which can again induce nine different reactions, then it leads to the creation of what is known as a chain reaction. So first you have one neutron, then you have three neutrons, then you have nine neutrons, then you have 27 neutrons, then you have 81 neutrons, and on and on and on, and suddenly you have a chain reaction of a large number of uranium nuclei disintegrating and releasing huge amounts of energy. This kind of a process is known as chain reaction, and this chain reaction happens in a nuclear explosion. In a nuclear explosion, you have this kind of an uncontrolled chain reaction that suddenly happens inside a bomb, and boom, you get a nuclear explosion. Now, this same reaction can be controlled in a nuclear reactor to produce electricity. How? So, if you have one neutron creating one reaction, but somehow you are able to negate the effects of two of these neutrons by, let's suppose, absorbing them by some kind of a material, then you end up controlling this chain reaction and controlling the explosive nature of this kind of a reaction. So for example, in nuclear reactors, what happens is that once this kind of a nuclear fission reaction is induced, the number of neutrons which are emitted, out of them, two of them are absorbed by some kind of a rod which has a material that can absorb these kind of thermal neutrons, and that way you control this reaction and the extent to which this happens, and then you can, and then if you sustain it, you are able to successfully create nuclear energy. So the same reaction which can create nuclear explosions is also creating power inside nuclear reactors. So this is one example of nuclear fission reactions. What about nuclear fusion? So let me also give you another example of nuclear fusion reactions. So one example of a nuclear fusion reaction is this, which happens inside the sun. In fact, four hydrogen nuclei combine together to create an alpha particle, leads to the emission of to positrons, to neutrinos, and huge amounts of energy. This energy can be calculated again by looking at the mass in defect involved between here and here. This is actually part of a complicated process which is known as the proton-proton cycle. I'm not going to explain too much detail here. This is just one example of a nuclear fusion reaction where smaller nuclei come together to create a little bit of a larger nuclei, but also leads to the emission of huge amounts of energy in that process. I might create another video discussing this kind of a proton-proton cycle in detail, or rather the two most important nuclear fusion reactions that happens inside the sun. We might make another video for that. But for today, this itself is, I think, enough. Thank you very much for watching.